The economic fundamentals of this country are strong.
We're in the middle of the worst economic crisis since the Great Depression.
Millions of people around the world are going to lose their jobs. Millions are going to lose their homes. Why? Because some greedy speculators were given free rein to focus on buying and selling pieces of paper.
I was laid off on December 22nd, 2008.
I'm one of the ones that were laid off when we lost the midnight shift.
Save our Chevron! Save our Chevron!
But our commitment to our members is to secure jobs.
Don't even mention taking my pension!
I'm gonna feel better if I fight than rather than stay and not do nothing.
32 years in the company, and what did they give me?
Nothing.
A boot. Yeah. I made them rich. This is what I got. No money, no severance.
As Canadians, we sit here, north of the United States, trading with East and West, just trying to get along, working hard and trying to be good neighbors. A major crisis hits in the fall of 2008, and signs of devastation are quick in succession. It's an American problem, our Prime Minister tells us.
This country is going to come through this period in a lot better shape than it's ever been before.
So why are these people throwing work boots at the finance minister's constituency office? It seems that the owners of these boots, people who lost their jobs in manufacturing, have a rather different point of view about Canada's fundamentals.
We're seeing for the first time since the 1930s a collapse of global production, which we just haven't seen for seven decades. What's different about this recession, though, is that more Canadians are entering it in a period of really high household debt, like we've never seen before. You add to that the fact that governments at both the federal and the provincial level have stripped back the layers of income support that prevent the middle class from doing a free fall into destitution. That's unemployment insurance and social assistance, both peeled right back. So we're entering this recession with Canadians more exposed to the economic risks of joblessness than at any time since the Great Depression.
This deep, hurtful economic recession can be felt across the nation. As Canada's largest private sector union, the Canadian Auto Workers Locals offer a unique window onto the effects of the downturn. Let's visit the site of the closed glass plant of Owens, Illinois, in Toronto.
When the plant closed, there was 480. In previous years, there was up to, I believe it was 800 before. This parking lot used to be packed full. We all received a letter when we came to work just saying that as of September 30th, the plant will be closed, and we weren't told you will be paid severance. People were completely shell-shocked, like tears, crying. There goes everything.
What about you?
There goes everything. That's everything to me, gone. So there's your security gone. And for me, it's not just me. It's me, my mother, my father was a previous employee. Its entire families are crippled. Like, houses are being lost, marriages are being broken up. This is the Local 29 OI Canada Corp Action Center. It's important for people to get out of the house, have a purpose, have somewhere to go. Everyone has houses they have to worry about, kids they have to worry about. No more drug plan anymore, no more dental plan anymore. These are things that people are worried about. So we all come together and support each other. So are you gonna be attending the computer course on Monday then? My son is the most important thing in my life. That's what I have to do in order to pay the rent. Ever since the plant closure, we've had to adjust everything. Being laid off, you've lost your total security.
It's been devastating. I mean, when one takes a look at the contract rollbacks being offered to us from multiple employers, suggesting that we are part of the problem is the most challenging aspects of the job, because people are now using this economic crisis as an opportunity to roll back hard-fought games of the past. So that's been the most frustrating area, trying to convince the Canadian public that this isn't about workers. This is about something bigger than workers' productivity and quality and efficiencies that are the buzzwords in the employers' communities.
My name is Jamie Hernandez, and I'm going right now with Arad, going Aramco crew. Membership, we're going to the Queen Park at Toronto for this rally to SOS, Save Our Severance. I lost my job back in May. Consequently, my marriage fell apart. Consequently, I lost all my belongings. I got my bed. I still have my bed. That's all I have left. And I have left my severance. That's what I thought. And now I'm empty hands. I don't have nothing. We decide we have to fight back. We have to get the attention of the politicians. We have to get the attention of the federal government. Someone have to do something.
Let's take a step back to when Jamie and his co-workers got desperate enough to take possession of Aradco in a bid to win their rightful severance. By preventing the company from removing their equipment, they won at least part of what was owed to them.
Don't underestimate the determination of our membership.
You know, that day when we decided to occupy the plant, it was in my mind. I'm gonna feel better if I fight than rather than stay and not do nothing. Now I can tell you I feel much better that we did that, that we did occupy the plant, because my self-esteem is building up. And I feel like it's worth it. It's worth it to fight.
Call us home and says, don't bother coming in. We've got bank issues.
What were you owed? $20,000. And how much of that did you actually see?
Not even a penny. Yeah. Not even one penny.
How you guys? Hi, Bobby. How are you? Good to see you again.
Hi, guys.
McDonald's? Okay? Good. Everything okay there, my friend?
It's tough, mate. It's really tough.
I was with the Aradco workers and other workers in the last 7 months. And the real story comes from their minds, from their eyes. When they got to go home and tell their kids they don't have a job. When they got to tell their kids they got no income. When they got to tell their families they got no security moving forward. And there's not a more painful moment in our minds and hearts of a worker when they have to do that. And if I hear one more time from this Minister of Labor that this is a federal responsibility, even though it affects workers in this province, he can kiss my ass! Yeah!
When they go bankrupt, we're at the bottom of the list of people that would receive what that bankruptcy provides. So at the end of the day, workers end up with nothing. The legislation is there, but there's no protection to give the workers the severance that they're required.
The financial crisis plunged two of the North American automakers, already struggling, far deeper into debt. On the brink of collapse, the governments of the United States, Canada, and Ontario came through with emergency funds with a number of conditions. One of those conditions demanded a new cost-cutting agreement with the UAW and CAW. In an effort to avoid company bankruptcy, the CAW had to go back to the bargaining table one more time to find ways of lowering costs without having a huge impact on the current workers and retirees. After two rounds of tough bargaining with each company, agreements were reached and overwhelmingly ratified, protecting wages, pensions, and the union's core values.
I've been elected as a trade unionist for about the last 43 years. I've been through some tough bargaining. I've been through bargaining in the 80s when Chrysler's almost went bankrupt, some real recessions in the auto industry in the late 80s, 90s, nothing. I've never experienced the uncertainty of, we had no idea where this was gonna end up. I mean, without the support, if we hadn't got the governments on side, quite frankly, I think the auto industry as we know it today would have been drastically changed.
Every single country that manufactures automobiles have provided economic and financial support to their industries, Japan, Germany, Korea, and yet they didn't attack workers. The only place they attacked workers in North America, United States and Canada. The stage was set for the Canadian and U.S. governments to reduce the expectations of auto workers during this time of crisis. If they would have come out and talked about the importance of the auto industry to the Canadian economy, it would have been a different environment totally.
Ken, what has the threat been to pensions?
Employers have used this global financial crisis to attack our core bargained pension benefits. Now, all of a sudden, people are saying it's unaffordable. It's not sustainable. The facts of the matter, it's unaffordable and not sustainable as a result of the deregulation of the financial markets. It has nothing to do with the employer's ability to pay.
Talked to a lady, 86 years old, on the phone, literally in tears when she called our local, didn't know what to do if she loses her income. And this is what we're facing across Canada today. And that's why we're here today. That's what it's all about.
In Kentville, in the Annapolis Valley, closure of the Eastern Protein plant devastated an entire community.
We're standing in front of the Eastern Protein plant here. This plant used to make chicken nuggets, further processed chicken. In February, they announced that it would be closing, laying off 187 CAW workers. This is a small community, right? And that took $10 million right, directly out of the community just in payroll alone. We've had a lot of businesses closed. We've lost the pork industry. Now, most of the chicken industry. We done a fight back against the closures. The government had just recently lent these guys $3.5 million, which they haven't given them all yet. So we had a rally in the town of Kentville asking all levels of government to hold that money until the employees were paid their severance and their vacation pay and their medicals brought up to date, which never happened. It's not just about us. It goes further than that. We're 200 workers here, but we got the truck drivers. We have the farm equipment places. We have tractor dealerships, car dealers. Everybody's affected by it. It's not just us. This is a sister plant to the Eastern Protein plant that closed in February. This plant is still operating. It's looking at being sold. The new buyer has already come in and asked for an $8 an hour concessions, which our membership has overwhelmingly rejected.
You know, on any year, an employer will come to the union, and if they had their way, they'd get rid of A, they'd get rid of B, they'd get rid of C, and while they're at it, they'd get rid of D. You know, and most of the time, we just tell them to get lost. When there's a recession on and there's a sense of crisis and a sense of confusion and workers are concerned and the public are concerned, then employers get really aggressive and they think, this is the time I'm going to win that. I've always wanted to get back A, B, C, and D, and this is the time that I'm going to do it.
The downturn has meant a reduction in ridership for Windsor's cabbies. Striking taxi drivers have been trying to force their employer to lower their costs.
The taxi cab drivers, our members of CAW Local 195, have been out on strike since April 2nd. We're trying to get the employer to recognize the fact when the economy goes down, so does the ridership for taxi cab drivers. He comes to the table asking the union for concessions due to the fact of the way the economy is.
Economy doesn't affect him to the company owner. No matter whatever it is, we have to pay him a lease. But for a driver, it's very hard.
We're not going anywhere until we get those rates down accordingly.
Our union stands for our justice, fairness against this company.
The strike has now been settled, with the taxi drivers winning reductions in rental and lease rates.
Sometimes, like with the auto companies, they really are broke. But that's still not justification for giving back your contract, because A, you can't save them by giving back your contract, and B, it wasn't your contract that caused the problem in the first place, so you're not going to solve the problem by doing it. Sometimes they're not broke, and they're just faking it, in essence. Think of the debates around some of the public sector strikes we're seeing, where governments are saying they can't afford stuff. That's nonsense. Governments have deficits, yes. You always have a deficit in a recession, but they can't afford to meet those goals, those standards that have been built up over years in history. So whether the employer is truly broke or not, we still have to hold the line, because in no circumstance was it our wages that caused the problem, or our pensions, or our benefits. And we accomplished nothing by giving that stuff back.
We're all owner-operators here. We run our own trucks, pay for our own bills. You get no pension, no EI. So basically, you're on your own for everything.
The curry industry in BC has seen a downturn. We've seen mills shut down. We've seen places reduce, which in turn has affected our customer base.
We've had layoffs to amalgamate runs, make them bigger.
Definitely didn't expect them to announce the whole call center would be gone. It was shock.
DHL is a multi-billion dollar company. Did they use the economy as a tool in bargaining? Yes, they did.
You know, our contract expired January 1st, and we couldn't pick a worse time in the world to go and bargain a contract.
It was a tough decision during bargaining, deciding on what to do. We had to look at our contract and what we had in there and how we could compensate these people as they were leaving. We had to look at compensation for people that were staying behind. What we negotiated was severance for owner-operators or dependent contractors, which we've never had. It gave us an opportunity to make sure that these people who have quite a bit of investment in their business have some money to go out and do other things.
Being on the negotiating committee the first time, it made me want to fight harder to extend the timing and get the best closure language I could for these people, because these are people that gave their life to the company. Good employees, good people. We fought to get the call center extended. They were originally wanted to be closed in April. We've got it to June 1st.
We joined forces with Ontario and Alberta, and us in BC. We joined together to bargain at the same time with the company. Otherwise, I think we would have been picked apart and totally taken advantage of. It was good to be together and have strength in numbers.
I'm very thankful for the friends that I've made with the CAW, who've supported not only me but the other members to get programs out to the people that have been laid off.
So since the middle of June, Flaherty, our finance minister, has been talking about economic recovery as if it's already starting, like we've turned the corner. But the fact is that they're using that as an argument to cut stimulus. Let us make no mistake about this. If government does not pour money into the economy, the gradual climb down of businesses and households that are way overextended in their spending way more money than they are making, is going to leave a huge hole. The only player that's left in this game plan to fill in the hole is government. And if they start pulling out that money, we are looking at a very long, very slow recovery.
The Premier said yesterday that
engagement
in
politics
round
is a key fight-back strategy during the recession. In light of Nova Scotia's long-standing economic challenges, CAW locals saw the opportunity to campaign for a more progressive government. A major flashpoint before the election was the Tory promise to eliminate the right to strike for healthcare workers.
So on May 15th, 2007, Rodney MacDonald, who was the Tory Premier at the time, announced that he was going to introduce legislation that was going to take away the right to strike for all healthcare workers in Nova Scotia.
This was an attack on the rights of healthcare workers that was unconscionable in this province.
We had a rally outside the house the day it opened in November.
The Premier made a last-ditch offer to meet with union officials, but union leaders refused to talk until the no-strike legislation is off the table.
So it sat there, and it continued to sit there until recently, when we just had our election, and the NDP were successful in getting a majority government. So now the legislation will be gone, and we have been successful in maintaining our right to strike for healthcare workers in Nova Scotia.
Well, the CAW and CAW members in this province have always played a great role in our campaigns. They make up virtually every conceivable office in riding associations. They're active during election campaigns. They're willing campaign volunteers. The reality is that, without their participation, without their support, it's quite likely that I wouldn't be in this position today.
In Halifax, the election ended a long stalemate with the government in the CAW's campaign to bring more work to the shipyard.
As shipbuilders, we are part of the manufacturing sector, and we have seen a major decline in the work that we're doing. You know, today we stand with 300 to 400 workers and our capacity. We could employ 1,500 to 2,000 workers here, employing half of the north end of Halifax. Canada needs approximately 50 vessels over the next 10 years. So the work is there. And we have a real chance to, you know, kind of breathe new life into the shipbuilding industry. Our fight is with government. And we have to join company and union together to lobby government the most effective way we can to get them to put those policies in place to allow us to become the shipyards that we should be. We felt that our Premier, Rodney McDonald, was not someone that was open to having conversations about workers' rights and what we felt were important to workers. So we felt it was important that we take a leading role in creating a government that will listen to us. I think if we have the will, then we can get an industry that really can provide an economic stimulus in a time when it's needed.
In spite of the grim economic outlook, locals 111 and 2200 in Vancouver launched a bold campaign to expand public transportation. Metro Vancouver had seen a 50% increase in ridership, working conditions had deteriorated, and morale was low. Locals 111 and 2200 ran a campaign to buy 500 more buses for Vancouver.
Bus drivers in Vancouver and in Metro Vancouver always thought they had a job for life. The economic downturn suddenly was a threat, and there was fears, and there's in the lunchrooms, people are worried. Things are happening with the downturn that you're hearing about all these CAW members getting laid off, and people got scared. More buses now was something that I could grab onto and say, hey, I'm gonna push because my job's important, and if we have more buses, they need me.
The More Buses campaign has been successful in engaging the public and the membership while pushing for Canadian-made buses.
The buses are overcrowded, so you're leaving people behind, and people are missing their medical appointments, people are missing to go to school, people are missing to go to work.
When you get left behind by the bus and you're late for work because of it, you take it out on someone, and usually we're the frontline employees, it's us that they take it out on.
Our motto here is fighting back makes a difference. And that's what part of this campaign is all about. So we need at least 500 more buses. Each bus will need at least two drivers. Also more members being hired for local CAW 2200 who provide the service and maintenance for the buses. We want to grow, we want to become stronger, we want to provide a better service to the communities that we serve.
It's always been CAW 111 and 2200, it's always been the position that new buses or used buses that come into the market that are driven by our members at Coast Mountain Bus Company are made in Canada. And we've been successful. We've lobbied TransLink for many years to get that commitment from them. And we see Novus, New Flyers, and the new buses that are coming online are all going to be built in Canada by our sisters and brothers in CAW locals across the country.
We got people that have never been involved in the union. We got them involved because they were excited. They could push back. They could say something. They could talk to people on their buses. They could hand them a brochure. They could wear a pin. We have lots of new people in the workforce, never been in a union. Suddenly they saw a way to get involved and they were happy. They were excited and it was that good news story.
Transit is political. And I think one of the most positive things out of this whole campaign has been how we've managed to educate our membership and mobilize our membership into the political arenas and get involved in political campaigns. Every day or every other day during the municipal and provincial campaigns, we were out there doing something, we were visible, we were in the press, and most importantly, we were motivating our membership.
The results of political engagement? 10 municipal candidates elected, 10 provincial candidates elected.
I'm a bus driver. This is where I work here, the Vancouver Transit Depot. And I'm the newly elected member of the Legislative Assembly for Vancouver Kensington. I attribute the success of my election, the provincial election, to a large part to my local CAW 111. From the leadership, the President Don McLeod, the full participation and support from the Union and Politics Committee and from all the operators in the local. They were a huge part and a big reason for my election victory.
The CAW was successful in convincing Toronto City Council to purchase streetcars from Bombardier in Thunder Bay. This will create 300 direct and 1,200 indirect jobs in Ontario.
Right now, in the economic crisis that the country is in,
You couldn't ask for a better time to be funding this, because this isn't just going to provide jobs in Thunder Bay. There's going to be a lot of jobs, direct jobs, in the production of parts throughout the rest of Ontario.
In Montreal, too, the TCA-CAW has successfully lobbied for municipalities to purchase locally manufactured vehicles.
The layoffs started gradually. We didn't go from 71 trucks to 28 trucks. There was a progression from 48 to 30, then 28. I imagine that PACCAR will try to profit from the crisis, to say in negotiations that they won't give you anything. Not officially, but we've heard they want to attack salaries and our insurance and retirement benefits.
I think municipalities can make a big difference. We are going to work hard on that and continue in our protests to increase awareness. The example of the mayor of Saint-Jérôme, that town bought five trucks this year. The town of Blainville bought two trucks last year.
Our work, rather, is done with elected officials. They hold the power and can make a difference. We can tell you that already, in some municipalities, we're getting lots of attention. There are some huge municipalities that did not even know that we make trucks in Quebec.
The hotel and tourism business is also suffering from the downturn. The result, layoffs and increasing pressure on service workers.
Personally, I was affected quite early because my department was shut down. I was at the minibar, closed in May. Since I have 27 years of seniority, I was able to benefit from the bumping clause and find work in another department. It's been 2.5 months since I've been at the cafe. When there's a crisis elsewhere, it affects us here because there are fewer travelers. There are fewer conventions held in Montreal. The hotel is less busy and there are fewer people at work. There are layoffs right now. Now the slow periods last longer, so people are worried. They don't know when they'll be back at work or if they will be able to get full-time work. So there's a lot of concern, a lot of concern. To have been able to move to another department when mine closed, that's thanks to the collective agreement. I wouldn't have been able to do it if I hadn't been unionized. If I hadn't been unionized, I would already be gone. So, for sure, it helps a lot.
Just recently, in the aerospace industry, we've lost significant jobs as a result of the global financial crisis, because the orders for jets and other things are being decreased as a result of corporations reducing cost.
I worked for 10 years at Honeywell, and then they closed the factory in 2008. I found work at Pratt & Whitney and worked for 8 months, and then there were layoffs due to the economic crisis.
2008 was a record year. We never made as many motors as we did in 2008. You see, it was around 4,000 motors. However, not long after, at the beginning of 2009, we had 500 layoffs.
I find it hard to be out of work for the second time because the industry is in a hole. All the aeronautics companies are laying off staff, so it's hard for us younger workers to find work in this sector.
200 people took early retirement, so it saved 200 jobs. But we still have 300 people who were laid off. For them, it's a more difficult situation.
Being unionized has helped me because I worked for 10 years in a unionized factory. After it closed, the TCA put in place a program. Well, it wasn't right after the closure. But there was a program in place to move people who were laid off to other TCA unionized factories.
We represent Air Canada workers. And the facts of the matter is we've been in crisis after crisis after crisis. Today, we're working to escape CCAA protection for a second time over a 5-year period. So here's airline workers with an Air Canada. Think about Air Canada potentially going to bankruptcy, our major carrier that provides the transportation necessary from one province to another, from one country to another, being in the position that they're at. And then today, even in retail, again, that I'm suggesting needs more attention because people are saying the jobs for the future are in service and retail. Well, why is it those jobs have to be low paid? And in those jobs today, guess what employers are saying? You're lucky to have a job. Never mind what we're paying you. Never mind the hours of work. You're just lucky to have a job. So the downward pressure that's applied to good paying jobs right down to the lowest paid in the economy obviously is having an impact.
Job security!
What do we want?
Job security!
It's going to have a ripple effect, very substantial ripple effect, in the Niagara area. I can say once again that manufacturing certainly does matter.
In 42 years, CAW Local 1451, we've had hung our head very high. If there's any issues to be taken on, we took them on. We never backed down. We never backed down from the government. We never backed down from social issues. And more importantly, we never backed down from the corporation. Keep it up. Thank you.
And thank you, Mike Devine.
There's less consumer spending. It impacts the retail sector. There's less goods being shipped. It impacts the transportation sector. There's less people flying. It impacts the airlines. Rail's being affected now because obviously there's less goods, there's less trains, there's less cargo. The mine mill, the ore, the price of ore has gone way down. In our Sudbury local, we've had major layoffs, and you can't see an end to the layoffs in any sector right now that's being impacted.
Hey, hey. Harper's government's gotta go.
In February 2009, Swiss mining company Xstrata laid off nearly 700 people from Mine Mill in Sudbury, breaking its contract with the federal government, the workers, and the city of Sudbury. And it did so with the blessing of federal industry minister Tony Clement. CAW Local 598 reacted in outrage at their double betrayal and organized rallies in Sudbury, Tony Clement's home office in Huntsville, and even made the trek from Sudbury to Ottawa to have their case heard.
We are then going to take our fight to Ottawa and make sure that everybody in this country knows exactly what Investment Canada is all about.
Severance was successfully negotiated for the laid-off workers, but the federal government has yet to explain why it took the side of a foreign company over its own citizens.
I've been driving for 23 years. You got 300 people sitting at home, and I think we got about 500 working right now. We had 800 members same time last year. Well, the members can't collect the UI or nothing because they're owner-operators. They're sitting at home starving, actually, and whatever work they get, they might get two days a week or one day a week, and they're trying to survive. Their wives are working, so that's the only way they can feed their family. We've been knocking on government's door for a while. They haven't done nothing yet for us, so I don't know what the future holds for us. Day by day, we're shrinking.
A look at the employment insurance, for example. Just recently, we had some momentum to change EI to protect workers that are losing their jobs through no fault of their own. And again, the Liberals made this a big announcement, and what comes out of it is a committee. We don't need another study. So what comes out of this? An activism, an appreciation for what is important to Canadians, an understanding that we got to mobilize, we got to politicize, we've got to be more active out there to generate consumers' public confidence in our direction versus government. We've got to mobilize. It's as simple as that.
We must collectively commit to the better cause. And to the CAW members up there, out there today, we are joined by unions from across this province. We are joined by social movements. We're joined by...
Canada is a world leader in fish and seafood production, but the recession, high fuel costs, and competition from countries such as China have devastated the fisheries industry. The government has been slow to create a long-term strategy for these challenges, and fishery workers are paying the price.
The processing industry in Newfoundland right now is in a downturn. Right now, the plant is closed. It's been closed for the past 2 months. They say it was because of the too much shrimp in the market and because of the downturn in the economy.
A dramatic increase in global supply has undermined shrimp markets to the point that prices to harvesters are less than half of what they were a decade ago. The shrimp industry has become so unprofitable that shrimp boats were tied up at the docks for nearly 2 months, putting both harvesters and shrimp plant workers out of work.
Stabilize this fishery. It's been going on long enough.
Shrimp harvesters and processing plant workers from the Northern Peninsula protest against the situation, calling for fair payment to fishermen and a reopening of the processing plants.
Without the fishermen, we will not survive. The plant workers can't survive. Factory freezers, they're not doing nothing for us. We're supporting our fishermen because they are our fishermen, and they're the ones that's putting food on our tables, and we support them 100%.
We've had the shrimp plants on this coast and the shrimp boats out of business for almost a month. 1,000 jobs in this area alone, 3,000 or more overall in the province, 3,500 jobs. Not a squeak. Why don't we hear the premier speaking out on that as the head of the government?
The prices that are being paid now affects everybody. The way it affects me is, like, these boats are not cheap boats. Obviously, I'm the primary one that's going to be affected because, you know, I've got bills to pay, I've got a, you know, bank to pay, and my crew members, they're probably the second ones that are affected big time. But, you know, that's five families that are affected. Every time these boats comes in, there's trucks involved in trucking it, there's people offloads it, there's people puts ice back aboard of it. There's probably 80 or 90 people that's processing my product at that one given time, you know.
It's not only the shrimp industry that's in trouble. Lobster harvesters have been getting terrible prices for lobster. To force some attention from the federal government, FFAW-CAW members occupied the offices of Federal Fisheries Minister Peter McKay. McKay was not there, but the provincial Minister of Fisheries did come to meet the protesters.
Atlantic Canada and Quebec.
Last week, we hauled 3 days. We hauled 1,400 lobster pots. We had 370 pounds of lobster. Time to pay for my gas, my bait. I had to get a cash advance at the bar to pay my share. I just talked to my wife and son just now. 62 pounds of lobsters. 420 pots. What do I do? Who's going to pay my installment on my boat this year? Is I going to lose my house?
We're in a position that we didn't make ourselves. The government caused the downturn in the fishery through too many fish plants, too many licenses, whatever. They caused the problem. We elected them to look after us. They didn't do it.
Well, to be honest with you, I would have loved to see my son continue on with fishing. I mean, he loves the water. He goes out on the boat, and, you know, he's only got 1 year of school left. Honestly, I really think if changes were made, there is a future there for the next generation. Right now, looking at it, no. I would never want any of my kids going into the fishery. Definitely not. Not the way it is now.
The six-week tie-up of the shrimp boats forced a better price from the processing companies. The economics of shrimp fishing were still marginal at best, but crews were once again able to head out onto the water. One day later, on July 14, 2009, responding to pressure from the union and the public, the government signed a memorandum of understanding with both the union and the processing companies to work towards a reorganization of the Newfoundland fishery industry.
We need to have a more coherent and coordinated presence in world markets. And I believe that the MOU forms the basis for doing that.
When we get going on these things, we're tenacious. And we plan to hang tough on that and to make sure that what comes out of this is a marketing strategy that does the best we possibly can to maximize the value we derive from the marketplace for those wonderful seafood products that our members produce. And I think we could borrow a page from Norway's book, where they use the phenomenal revenues that flow from offshore oil to stabilize and strengthen their traditional renewable industries for the long haul. And I think we need to have a similar approach here.
I'm working over here 2 days a week, as a part-time in the afternoons. This is the Labor Adjustment Center, Local 195. It's a place that help people that is being laid off from the companies that are unionized, but we help people that they come in out of non-union shops too. Basically, I'm overcoming all this situation. I enrolled in the second career program, and then I was approved for dental assistance. By December, I'll be finished. So I'm ready to go to the workforce. I got my kids every day. I have this place. It's okay for my kids, you know. It's a transition. That's the way I look at it. But I can't play dead. You know what I mean? I cannot stay down.
For me, school is my plan. I want to go to school. I have to take upgrading now because I didn't make September. I'm going to upgrade from now until September. I'm going to work part-time on the side. I hope nursing is where I end up, if not somewhere related to that.
Both Jamie and Amy are showing remarkable resilience in continuing to fight for work in the midst of a downturn. But their stories are not unique and find common links with Canadians affected by the recession from coast to coast. It's a collective struggle. What is clear is that the CAW has provided them with the empowerment and the means to persevere on their path to a secure livelihood. These are not easy times, and the need for the Canadian Auto Workers Union and organized labor has never been greater.
You know, it was for the workers that put forth the effort. It was nothing our government did. It was nothing our company did. You know, here's to all of us for doing what we're doing and forcing these guys to do what they should be doing.
If it wasn't for the efforts of the CAW and supporting the non-union people as well by extending their arm and inviting us to functions just like this, we would be very lost. So thank you very much for the invitation and keep up with the fight.
You're going to have to see the unions reinvent themselves. We have to be more creative. We have to be more innovative. We have to give young people a reason to believe that the union can work in their best interest. And the only way that you can do that is reaching out to them. We have to change with the times. Unions are not automatic, whether they're old unions or new unions, whether they're old members or new members. I still believe, as a result of the experiences that we're going through today, I believe we can mobilize, I believe we can build some activism, I believe we could generate some excitement, I think we can take advantage of this crisis here today, because who's providing hope outside of the labor movement? Who's speaking for those that have lost their jobs and most vulnerable outside the labor movement?